I wrote it and then I changed it this morning. So it's probably nothing. Good morning, brothers and sisters, and welcome to Our Lady of Lourdes. Please stand.
O people of Zion, behold, the Lord will come to save the nations, and the Lord will make the glory of his voice heard in the joy of your heart.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Happy Sunday. It's good to be with you on the second Sunday of Advent. My name is Father Daniel. I'm a priest friend and companion with Father Brian Larkin, your pastor. So it's a great joy to be with you today as we celebrate as we continue to celebrate the season of Advent, as we approach the coming of our Lord at Christmas. So, dear brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate more worthily these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Kyrie
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, may no earthly undertaking hinder those who set out in haste to meet your Son, but may our learning of heavenly wisdom grant us admittance to his company, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Comfort, give comfort to my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her service is at an end. Her guilt is expiated. Indeed, she has received from the hand of the Lord double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the wasteland a highway for our God. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill shall be made low. The rugged land shall be made a plain, the rough country a broad valley. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Go up onto a high mountain, Zion, herald of glad tidings, cry out at the top of your voice, Jerusalem, herald of good news. Fear not to cry out and say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. Here comes with power the Lord God, who rules by his strong arm. Here is his reward with him, his recompense before him. Like a shepherd, he feeds his flock. In his arms, he gathers the lambs, carrying them in his bosom, and leading the ewes with care. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
kindness and grant us
truth shall meet. Justice and peace shall kiss. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and justice shall look down from heaven.
A reading from the second letter of St. Peter. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day. The Lord does not delay his promise, as some regard delay, but he is patient with you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a mighty roar, and the elements will be dissolved by fire, and the earth and everything done on it will be found out. Since everything is to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be? Conducting yourselves in holiness and devotion, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved in flames and the elements melted by fire. But according to his promise, we await new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you await these things, be eager to be found without spot or blemish before him, at peace. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I am sending my messenger ahead of you. He will prepare your way. A voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths.'" John the Baptist appeared in the desert, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. People of the whole Judean countryside and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they acknowledged their sins. John was clothed in camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He fed on locusts and wild honey. And this is what he proclaimed: "One mightier than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop and loosen the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I don't know how many of you have heard of Ghent, Minnesota, but as of 2 months ago, I had never heard of it either. It's a tiny little town in southwest Minnesota, maybe 200 residents. But a few weeks ago, I drove out there because my cousin was receiving her veil as a sister. She entered into a community of sisters maybe a year ago, and she received her habit and her new name, which was a fantastic opportunity to go out and to pray with them, their community. Her name is now Sister Zita, which is fun to say. Zita, well, Sister Zita. So pray for her. But as I was driving out there, I landed in St. Paul, Minneapolis, and rented a car and drove. And the highways were flat, straight, and went on for a long time. And as you drive in the Midwest, if you're familiar with the Midwest, or you get out to the eastern plains of Colorado, you start to feel a difference as you leave Denver. Maybe not just politically, yes. Things start to change. But you can start to feel the difference from city, noisy, chaotic life into sometimes an even louder silence. You can feel sometimes the silence. The silence sometimes is loud as it rings in our own head. And this can be a challenge, because sometimes all of a sudden, our own thoughts, our own things that we've never really dealt with or addressed start to bubble to the surface. In the gospel this morning, from the very beginning of the gospel according to Mark, there's a quote from Isaiah the prophet. Mark, as a gospel writer, is pointing to John the Baptist and saying, John the Baptist is the messenger that all of the Old Testament was foretelling, that there would be a messenger preparing the way for the Christ, for God himself to come. And we know we're familiar with John the Baptist. He's eating bugs and honey in the wilderness. He's baptizing people in the Jordan, and he's wearing strange clothing like camel fur and a leather belt. But the quote from the prophet Isaiah, which we heard in the first reading as well, is this: "A voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths.'" Now, this might sound very familiar, and you're like, well, yes, it's Advent, great. Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths. Cool, Christmas is coming, let's prepare. Make a straight highway for our Lord. But if we look back at the first reading, the real context of the prophet Isaiah, it helps to flesh out a little bit more what's going on in the context of the prophet. This is from the 40th chapter of the book of Isaiah. And this is a turning point in the whole book. The first 39 chapters are often called the book of judgment or the book of doom sometimes. But it's basically 39 chapters of prophesying the destruction of the people Israel and their city if they do not repent and turn back to the Lord. And God is saying, danger is coming. The Assyrians to the north will come and destroy your city if you do not repent and turn to the Lord. And then because of the fidelity of the king of Israel and because of the fidelity and the turning back of the people, God spares them. Assyria is stopped, and the people are not completely destroyed. But they are left in fear, shaken up, persecuted, and afraid. They're not in the most stable place, you could say. And thus begins the next several chapters of the book of the prophet Isaiah. And it begins with this word, comfort. Comfort, give comfort to my people, says your God. So the context is the people of Israel are not super stable, awesome, super holy, just doing fantastic things all the time, totally measuring up to their own standards, God's standards, or the standards of their neighbor. But rather, they're in a fairly weak, broken, worn down place. And it's from this place that the prophet Isaiah calls out to the people of Israel. And what does he say? A voice cries out, colon, in the desert prepare a way for the Lord. That's a little bit different from the gospel. The gospel, if you remember, it says, there was a voice in the desert crying out, prepare the way of the Lord. But in Isaiah, it says, a voice cries out, what? In the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. The people of Israel are in a real and spiritual desert. They're in weakness. They're confronted by their infidelity and their sin. They're not measuring up. And the Lord says, even there, prepare a way for the Lord. And what is the way that John the Baptist then teaches us? When we go into the wilderness, when we go into silence, we're often faced with our own weakness, with our own sinfulness. You look inside and you might say, I don't measure up yet again. I'm not where I'm supposed to be yet again. I have sinned yet again. I'm not worthy. I can't measure up. And the Lord says, even there, prepare a way for me. And this is what silence does to us. Silence gives us the space, mentally and especially from our hearts, from the noise of the world. Today, I think more than ever, when everyone's shut inside and the only thing you hear is through technology, through media, through all of these different voices and talking heads that come at us, the noise can clutter our hearts, the noise can clutter our ears and our minds. Sometimes it's the drama within your own family, your children who never, ever stop making noise, except for when they're asleep. But the reality is we're immersed in a world of noise. And Advent becomes the time to prepare the way of the Lord, to go out like Ghent, Minnesota, to go out like John the Baptist in the wilderness, to go out into the desert where it is silent and still, so that our Lord can then speak to us. But again, what happens is sometimes things are bubbling up, things we haven't thought about in a long time. Old wounds, old sins, old relationships that hurt and haven't been dealt with. Weaknesses that still crop up and we push away. And as these things bubble up, we can think, I can't do silence. I can't pray in silence. I like praise and worship music, which is good. I like praying the divine office, which is good. I come to Mass, and Mass is my prayer, yes, which is good. But the reality is, if our hearts every single day do not have a moment of silence to let God speak to our hearts, then those areas are never dealt with. Those areas are never brought into the light. So if there's three steps, the first step is make space for silence. This Advent, get off Instagram. What? Yes. Lessen the intake from the world and increase the input from God and the scriptures. Make space for silence. Set a corner in your house where each day, 15 minutes, begin there. In silence, listen to where God might be speaking to you and speak to him where you are. If you don't measure up, welcome to the family. If you're not perfect, you're in a good place. Because the Lord says, there I want to come. I want to come dwell there. But we must enter into silence. So step one, silence. Step two, the honest engagement with your own weakness, with my weakness. It's not easy to look at. But it's not a way that we enter in and we just say, fix everything. Weakness is bad, sure. Sin is evil, yes, it is. But God wants to enter into it, not just avoid it and completely get rid of our weakness. When we try to simply fix these things, it can actually create more problems. Because we're relying first and foremost on ourselves and not on his mercy. Does God want our conversion? Yes. Does God want us to be rid of sin and temptation? Yes. But he wants to do it by his power. There's a simple pattern linguistically that can help with this. When I find issues, I fix, and it leads to self-hatred because I can't fix myself. But when we allow Jesus in the silence to come into our heart this Advent, Jesus reveals, Jesus heals, and even if we fail again, it doesn't lead to self-hatred, but to unconditional love. Jesus heals, Jesus reveals, and it leads to love. The third step then would be wherever there is need for repentance, and this is what John the Baptist cries out. Repent, the kingdom of God is near. Turn away from your sins and come back to the Lord. There's a penance service, I think, on the 17th of December here. Come to confession. Prepare well. Make a good confession. Because that straightens the path for the Lord. Silence, honest transparency, and repentance. These are the practical ways that the scriptures, John the Baptist, and the season of Advent itself present to us as Catholics to say, Christ is coming, and he will come. Will we be ready when he's here? We can shift these gears simply to today, the second Sunday of Advent. How did you prepare for Mass today? I'm not trying to guilt trip you. Some of you have 15 children, and it's hard to juggle. Father Nathan Goebel always says, for every child you have, you get 5 minutes late off of Mass. So if you have enough children, it's like, well, you know. But it's helpful. There's no pressure. If you need to take care of your children, come to Mass if you're late. Great, come, be here. But the reality should be that every Sunday that you come here to Mass, what happens? God himself is made incarnate upon the altar. Just like at Christmas, God himself is made incarnate in the manger. And in the church, we have a whole season of 4 weeks to prepare for the coming of Christ in silence, in prayer. So every Sunday, our preparation for the Holy Mass should be the same. Before Mass, whether at home, in the car, here in the pews, have a miniature Advent before every Mass because Christ is coming. And in silence, and in honesty, and in repentance, we prepare for his coming into our lives. He wants to speak. He wants to speak mercy and love and transform us by his coming. But we must first be disposed. When we pray with the Mass, have you looked at the readings ahead of time? Sometimes I admit I haven't, and I'm the priest that's supposed to preach. When you pray the Mass, have you looked at the prayers that we will pray for today? Again, this isn't a guilt trip. This is an invitation. Come, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight the highway for our God. And if you're weak, if you're sinful, if you're suffering, welcome to the family. Right where you are, prepare with the text, prepare with the readings. Come, sit in silence. In the Mass, when we pray the collect, the priest says, "Let us pray." And then the rubrics actually say, "Take a moment of silence before you begin the prayer." Because at that moment in the Mass, we're supposed to be collecting the collect, collecting all of our intentions, all of the people we want to pray for, all of the things that we offer up to the Father. That is the moment where we, in silence, address the reality of our heart and present ourselves to God to be disposed to receive him. After communion, yes, we'll have hymns to praise God, but we need to sit in silence so that Jesus, who dwells within us as we have prepared for him, might speak to our hearts. So at the end of the day, there's three comings of the Lord. The final coming of the Lord, the second coming of the Lord, is when he comes in glory at the end of time, or at the end of our life when we die and we're presented before the Lord and we're judged. We must prepare for that day. The first coming is the coming of Christ at Christmas. Jesus comes into the darkness of the world, into the brokenness of the world, to redeem us. But every single day and every single Sunday, there is another coming of Christ in the most holy Eucharist. So today, next Sunday, every daily Mass you attend, may we approach it with faith, with the eyes to see the swaddled babe in the manger, with the eyes to see Christ the King coming in glory. And in this season of Advent, may our hearts be prepared through silence, honesty with the Lord, and repentance, so that he might enter deeply into us, convert us when we don't measure up. And in our weakness, make us one with him who desires to come and dwell in you. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The coming of our Redeemer was foretold by the prophets. By preaching repentance from sins, John the Baptist heralded his appearance. In the spirit of penance, let us seek God's help through our prayers.
That Holy Church may reveal the glory of the Lord for all peoples to see, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christian leaders may work for justice and peace based on divine mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who dwell in residences of assisted living and extended care, and for their caregivers, that they provide a nurturing environment of loving patience, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick who seek healing and wholeness, especially Joe Radonovich and Eliza Lynn Michaud, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those whose deaths we recall may enjoy light, pardon, and peace, especially Kevin McNicholas, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the God of mercy will hear the prayers we now offer in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Most loving Father, look upon the needs of our people and grant our petitions as we prepare a way for your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Jesus, Jesus.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be pleased, O Lord, with our humble prayers and offerings, and since we have no merits to plead our cause, come, we pray, to our rescue, with the protection of your mercy, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the design you formed long ago, and open for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty, and is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which now we dare to hope. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, Veni sunt caeli et terra, Gloria tua. Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus, qui venit in nomine Domini. Hosanna in excelsis.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium fidei,
mortem tuam,
annunciamus Domine, et tua resurrectionem confitemur, donec venias.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Samuel, our Bishop, Jorge, his assistant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
On you stay.
Quis tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. On you stay. Quis tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona nobis pacem.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Replenished by the food of spiritual nourishment, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that through our partaking in this mystery, you may teach us to judge wisely the things of earth and to hold firm to the things of heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A few announcements right here. Our parish offices and schools will be closed this Tuesday, December the 8th, for the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, the Solemnity. Mass times are the Anticipatory Mass Monday at 6 p.m., and then 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. on Tuesday, on the 8th. So Mass is on the 7th and the 8th. If you haven't already done so, please make sure to sign up for a Christmas Mass. You will find the full December Mass schedule on our website. Mark your calendars for the penance service on December 17th from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. We will have 2 to 3 priests available at all times throughout the day and evening from 2 to 8 on December 17th. An anonymous donor has graciously offered a $25,000 year-end match for our school. We need your support more than ever, and our year-end match is a great opportunity. If you are registered, you should have received an envelope in the mail. You can also call the parish office to make a donation. Thank you for your generosity. This year, we are hosting a virtual Jesse tree to provide gifts to families that need extra help. With COVID, the need is greater than ever. Please visit our website, lourdesdenver.org, to view the requested gifts. All gifts must be returned to the church by December 14th. Thank you in advance. Don't forget to check out Father Brian's new podcast, Gregorian Rant. You can find it on the website at lourdesdenver.org. A shameless plug right there. There you go. I've heard it's great. Again, during this Advent season, as the silence builds, I do want to emphasize that the voice of the Lord speaks mercy. So if you enter into the internal silence of your heart and you hear accusation, you hear despair, you hear anxiety, that's not from the Lord. Listen for the voice of mercy. When Jesus sees the woman caught in adultery, he says, "My daughter, has no one accused you?" She says, "No one, Lord." He says, "Neither do I. Go and sin no more." So he recognizes it, forgives, and then restores her back to life. And that's how he speaks to us. So learn the voice in the silence between the accuser and the merciful Lord. And that can help tremendously in our prayer. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Bow your heads for a blessing.
May the Almighty and merciful God, by whose grace you have placed your faith in the first coming of his only begotten Son, and yearn for his coming again, sanctify you by the radiance of Christ's advent, and enrich you with his blessing.
Amen.
As you run the race of this present life, may he make you firm in faith, joyful in hope, and active in charity.
Amen.
So that rejoicing now with devotion at the Redeemer's coming in the flesh, you may be endowed with the rich reward of eternal life when he comes again in majesty.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God. St. Michael the Archangel,
defend us in battle.
Be our protection against the wickedness and snares, of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls.